So for the next person to come and share with us what not wasting his 100 means to him is my friend Chris. Chris is also the immensely talented Nathaniel Orr's father, so he's got a lot to answer for. So Chris, whenever you're ready.
I'm Nathaniel's father. Nathaniel is my son. He's the one with all the talent, and I just get to pay the bills. Very, very few people know me before my Christian life. In fact, the only people that I can actually say knew me before I was a Christian is my immediate family, my mum, my dad, my brother, my sister. The reason for this was my dad was in the Royal Air Force, and we moved around about every 18 months, every 2 years, from one place in the UK to another. So you never actually got into a situation where I guess some of you have known each other for quite a while and, you know, perhaps grown up together and know each other quite well. I never had that. As a child, I had no school friends or anything like that, so there'd be no point going on Friends Reunited because I wouldn't find any. Very sad. In fact, it's safe to say that my life philosophy could be summed up in the words of a song by Bob Geldof, who wrote for the Boomtown Rats and released in 1978 the song Like Clockwork. Some of your parents may know this. Great, great song. Especially the phrase that goes, "Count the hours, count the minutes, at the months and minutes. You're born in tears, you die in pain, that's your limit. You're looking for some earthly reason, but there's none there. Why don't you admit it? We make the most of what we've got, that's your ticket." It's a very depressing philosophy, actually, to live by, and it was well suited to me because at the time I was a very, very depressing person to be with. I found comfort in smoking. At the age of 16, I was able to smoke 60 cigarettes a day, a few cigars, and when I used to go night fishing, I'd take a pipe with me to keep the mosquitoes away. It works. I don't recommend it. I like to drink, but not too much, as I didn't like the after effects of the hangover. I had enough issues of my own without adding to them. And there was a phase in children of my generation, we lived through what was called the Cold War. Now, you may learn about it in history, but that was real life to the likes of me. And there came a point when I realized that a nuclear holocaust was a distinct possibility. They used to call it mutual assured destruction, MAD, and it was. You fire on us, we fire on you, everybody dies, good job. And I began to research how to survive this catastrophic event. And the more I researched it, the more I realized I didn't actually want to survive a nuclear holocaust. I actually wanted to be the target and get it all over and done with quick. And I became the bearer of this rather morose and joyful philosophy and would talk about this with as many people as I could find interested in it. And actually, you would be surprised how many people had a similar worldview at the time. Of course, when you look back, this was no great surprise because we all went to the same schools. We were all taught the same philosophies. We were educated through the schools. We were educated through the media. This is what we were taught. This is what we believed. This is how we lived our lives. No surprise. I sometimes wonder what would have happened to me if things had not changed. And I do wonder what happened to those of my generation who perhaps carried on their lives believing what they were taught in school and what they were taught in the media. Thankfully, it's something that I can only ponder and I don't have to worry about it with any regret or anything like that, because life changed for me in 1981. I'd managed to get myself an apprenticeship in London, and I left home when I was 17 years old. It was my first time away from home. It was the first time on my own. It was an absolute, complete and unmitigated disaster. The first year was sheer hell. I went to London. I discovered that London was a very, very, very expensive place to live. Still is a very expensive place to live. Not as expensive as Singapore. And I discovered I would have to share digs with three other colleagues who were on apprenticeships the same as I. We signed up for the rent for 12 months. We got ourselves installed. And at that point, I realized they all took drugs of various different kinds. The place stunk. There was stuff growing all over the place. And when they had a party, it really was like something out of The Last Battle or an Armageddon movie. It was horrendous. I am so glad my parents never saw that place. When these were all three colleagues that I worked with, and a day came when somebody disappeared from the office. And eventually, we got a bit concerned about him, went to look for him, found him locked in the toilets. He'd actually taken drugs at work and had a drug overdose, and he was unconscious. Needless to say, he lost his job. The last I heard of him was he was back into his mother's home. He was at the top of the staircase with a shotgun aimed at the bottom, waiting for his stepfather to arrive. I don't know what happened in the end. Shortly after that, another colleague, not a housemate, we went round to his place and had to try and break down his bathroom door. He'd locked himself in. He'd tried to have an overdose of paracetamol and had attempted to slit his wrists, purely because his girlfriend had dumped him. He survived, but he was a very, very, very damaged individual. They're just two examples of the situation that I was actually living in on my first venture away from home. My life could have gone exactly the same way. I was in danger. I was right in the center of this, in danger of being sucked in with all the things that were going on around. I was 17 years old, and this was the first few months of being away from home. One night, my administrator at work asked me if I'd like to go to a meeting with him. And quite frankly, I said yes, just to get out of the flat and perhaps meet some decent people, people who didn't have issues. Everybody I knew had issues, including me. The meeting was amazing. It was actually a Christian gathering, and I didn't know that before I went, but I was sort of expecting, you know, the old ladies with the blue rinse hair and all the other sort of goodies that you associate with church things when you don't know anything about it. It was actually full of the same-aged people as me, same age as you are now. And there was about 100 plus people there. Absolutely amazing. All good looking. Really great looking people. There was a band like we've had tonight. There was the drums, there was the electric guitar, there was the electric bass, there was the keyboard, there was a trumpet, there was a trombone, there was a saxophone. You name it, it was there. And the sound that they made was absolutely out of this world. Not just with the instruments, but as they sang. I mean, they really did pour their hearts and souls into what they were singing. I was having a whale of a time. This was the first good time since I left home. Well, after a little while, it all went very quiet, and some guy who I never saw before, never saw or since, don't know his name, but he got up to speak. And he began in his talk and was talking about all sorts of other things. Then all of a sudden, he began to describe my life. I'd never met this guy before. I'd never met anybody in that room before. But he began to describe my life almost from start to finish, and it was really scary. It was really quite terrifying. And I began to think that the people around me probably knew that it was me they were talking about. Of course, that was quite ridiculous because I'd never ever met any of them before and I'd never been introduced to them before. Anyway, when this guy sat down, a lady at the front got up and she said, "You know, the Lord Jesus is speaking to someone here tonight and he's inviting that person to be forgiven and accept eternal life." At this point, my heart was in my mouth. It was beating at 200 to the dozen. I could hardly breathe. The air seemed to have been evacuated from the room, and I really did feel like every eye in the place was on me. Someone had noticed me coming in. Jesus had noticed me coming in. And that night, he made me an irresistible offer. He said, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." At 17 years old, away from home, I was a boy who was very weary, who was very heavy laden with the cares of the world that shouldn't have been mine. And I really did need a long rest. I was stuck in the middle of a row of people, and for a few seconds I calculated how awkward it was going to be to push past all these people to get out. It's a bit like being at the cinema, and there you are watching the film, and all of a sudden a parent decides they want to take their child to the toilet. So up they get, and up you all get all the way along the line, and then you all sit back down again, and then you wait for them to come back, and then you all get up, and just like that. That was me. I hesitated and wondered whether I could perhaps do this thing, whatever it was, quietly, sometime later. And then I panicked and thought, well, perhaps this is a once and only offer. And if I miss the opportunity, then I won't get it back again. After what seemed like an eternity, but really was probably only about 20 seconds, I eventually stood up and I didn't bother asking anybody to move. I just pushed and shoved and barged my way out of these chairs and made a beeline for this woman at the front. I knew precious little about the Bible then, and this lady kept talking to me about the Bible. And with hindsight, I now realized that she was pointing out the state of man, the need of a savior, and the fact that that savior is Jesus. All I remember thinking inside and was screaming inside was, where's Jesus? Show me Jesus. I need Jesus. Eventually, she asked me if I wanted to give my life to Jesus. I was amazed. I remember being amazed that Jesus was interested in me and willing to make such an offer. I knew at this point, I could feel his eyes staring into me. I knew at this point there was nothing hidden in my life, absolutely nothing. There were no secrets. There were no places that weren't unexplored by his gaze. But I also remember I didn't feel at all afraid because I knew he loved me. I also knew that I was detestable in his eyes, but there was an offer on the table. I said yes without a second's hesitation. And the lady asked me to repeat a prayer of confession after her. I wanted to make sure that everybody heard this prayer because, after all, if Jesus was willing to identify with me, I wanted everybody in that room to know that I was now his. As I prayed this prayer, I could feel the weight of my past, short as it was, lifting from my shoulders. My anxiety, my fear, my obsessions, my depressions, my hopelessness, all my unfulfilled expectations, all my sin. I felt it all lifting from my shoulders and being placed squarely and firmly on the shoulders of the man and Calvary. The hymn writer writes this: my sin, O the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I know exactly what that hymn writer means. For the first time in my life, I was free. I was completely clean. I was guiltless. I was now adopted into Jesus' family. I had become a child of God. I was guaranteed an eternal life. What a night out! It was the best night out I'd ever had. From that moment, my life completely changed. Gone was the smoking. Gone was the bad language. Gone was the blasphemy. Gone was the lies. And believe me, this isn't just because I decided to turn over a new leaf, because I've been practicing these things for nigh on 17 years. And you don't give up bad habits like that. From that moment on, my life had a meaning, a purpose, a direction, and a goal. Gone was the count the hours, count the months, and count the minutes. You're born in tears, you die in pain, and that's your limit. I no longer count the hours. I no longer count the months. I no longer count the minutes. I was no doubt born in pain, and I no doubt cried at my birth. But that's healthy. That's good. All healthy babies do that. And mothers will cry in pain when they're giving birth, but when the baby is placed in the mother's arms, the tears will become tears of joy. That's healthy. I may die in pain, but that, dear friends, is not my limit. That is not where it ends. Rather, that's where it begins. Once I pass through death's door, that's when my life really begins. That's when my eternal life starts. That's when it all starts going well. New body, no pain, no suffering, no mistakes, no regrets, no anxieties, no depression, only love, joy, and peace forever in the presence of my Savior Jesus. He is the one who, when I die, will say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Come into my home and rest. Elliot asked me to speak about what it means not to waste my 100. The first 17 years of my life were a complete and utter waste. They counted for absolutely nothing, and they would probably have been better not lived. But Jesus answers that question when he says, store up treasures in heaven where moth and rust doesn't corrupt, nor thieves break in and steal. I'm pretty sure that most of you know Nathaniel. If you didn't before, you certainly do now. And a good number of you perhaps know the trials and the tribulations that we as a family have been through. Particularly with regards to work. Since November, I've been on month-by-month extensions, and That's all well and good, except for the fact that they don't announce the next extension until perhaps the day before you're due to finish, which makes planning and living very, very, very difficult. There was one occasion I actually had 1 week's extension. That was very, very troubling. At least it was at first. But after a while, you get used to it. After a while, you begin to realize that actually it's God that provides the daily needs, the house, the food, the clothes, and so on and so forth. And to date, we have never gone without. Over the past 2 years, I've really begun to learn what it is to live by faith and not to rely on what I can do and how well I can do it. My contract has just finally come to an end, so I am looking for work. I've been offered 5 jobs to date. Well-paid jobs, great career moves with a huge amount of kudos and respect attached to each of them. I could make an excellent case for accepting any one of them, and no one would be able to find fault with any of my reasoning. In reality, the obvious thing to do would be to choose the one that offers the biggest bucks and the best perks and the longest duration and jump for that. And no one again would be able to fault me for it. Neither could they, because I'm duty-bound to provide for my wife and my children. That is my expectation, that's their expectation, that's what God's expectation of me is. But there is one problem with this. I firmly believe in the very core of my being that God has told me that we're to stay in Singapore for the medium term. Therefore, now when I make my decision about work, I have to balance the obvious decisions with the need to walk the way that I believe God is telling me. The choice I've made is to be obedient to what I believe God is telling me to do. It's hard, as everything inside you screams, take this one, do this. This is your get out of jail free card. You'll be okay. Don't risk it. But to take the easy option is like saying to God, I don't trust you. And if I can't trust him to keep his promise to clothe, feed, and house me, then how can I trust him for the bigger things like saving me from sin? 30 years ago, I made a decision to follow Jesus wherever he leads me, however he guides me, to the best of my ability and my understanding at the time. And I don't regret 1 minute of it. That's not wasting your 100. There are no regrets. Everyone here will make a decision as to whether or not to follow Jesus tonight. Some will say yes, others will say no. And assuming tomorrow comes, we'll all make decisions tomorrow. And some may decide tomorrow to follow Jesus, and some may still decide no. And so it goes on, but one day, there will not be a tomorrow. And on that day, you're stuck with the decision you made yesterday. This world is passing away, and I'm sure if you read the papers, as we were encouraged to as at your age, you will see that there's a lot of trouble and a lot of bad in the world, and it's not a good place to be. This world is passing away. It's failing badly. The boat that we're in is sinking, and it's time to set our eyes on the eternal things, the things that are going to last, and to build for when real life, when eternal life begins. Store up treasures in heaven. It's great to get a good college degree. It's great to get a new house. It's great to get a new car. It's great to have your first family. But ultimately, all these things, they are dust in your hands, and they will pass through your fingers. Because when it comes to death, you can't take them with you. It's only what you've prepared on the other side that's going to carry any weight at all. I would encourage you all this evening not to wait any longer. There's a heaven to be gained, there's a hell to be shunned, and one or other will be the destination for each of us. But we make that free will choice here on earth. Choose Jesus and choose life. Don't waste your 100. Thank you.